This is Dr. Catherine Bankole-Medina, and in today's podcast, we make a note on the Ku Klux Klan in 1871. By 1870, African Americans represented more than 12% of the American population. As a people, they had endured the horrors of the Middle Passage Ma'afa and generations of American slavery. The slave codes subjugated blacks in a manner unprecedented in United States history. When the 13th Amendment to the Constitution abolished slavery in the United States, there was a sense of liberatory hope born out of more than two centuries of suffering and survival. However, African Americans continued to pay the price for their hard-fought freedom. There are many histories and interpretations regarding the original purpose of the Ku Klux Klan in the United States. Some scholars emphasize that it was originally founded in Pulaski, Tennessee as a social club. Historians and scholars agree that after their formal establishment in 1866, the organization was resolute in their efforts to terrorize people of African descent. They were one of several groups dedicated to the vigilante policing of blacks and other violent activities devoted to keeping African Americans, quote, in their place, unquote, especially during the post-war Reconstruction South. The Klan expressed an incredible resentment and fear of the Southern freedmen. During this time, from 1866 through 1871, the Klan gained popularity, but was not yet a centralized organization. The local community-based Klan units used their power to summarily execute or otherwise lynch blacks, largely through hanging. In 1871, Congress collected testimony about the terrorist activities of the Klan and published a 13-volume document entitled, Report of the Joint Select Committee appointed to inquire into the condition of affairs in the late insurrectionary states. The report collected testimony from several southern jurisdictions, including the Carolinas, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, and Florida. The information exposed their tactics, which included intimidation, humiliation, ridicule, physical threats, and murder. While the Klan was largely concerned with expressions of freedom and citizenship among blacks, they also targeted Northerners that had migrated south after the Civil War, called carpetbaggers. They would also later turn their attention to Catholics, immigrants, and Jewish people. The congressional documents specifically reveal that the Ku Klux Klan worked to keep blacks from teaching literacy skills. They were also most concerned about black participation in government, including voting and holding elected office. The testimony revealed that the Klan burned homes, beat black residents for perceived community slights to whites, took possession of land owned by blacks, and chastised educated blacks. Klan violence was so pervasive, Congress introduced the 1870 Force Act and the 1871 Klan Act, sometimes referred to as the Ku Klux Klan Acts, to prosecute the Klan and halt their activities. This caused the Klan to weaken. African Americans would continue to endure decades of systematic segregation, disfranchisement, and Klan violence and intimidation of varying degrees. By 1915, the Klan was revitalized, and in the 1920s, the Klan expanded to the North and Midwestern states. With membership in the millions, the Klan rededicated its violent efforts, and it did so with the complicity and/or sympathy of law enforcement, government officials in some cases, and with the support of the community. The Klan and Klan-like organizations developed their white supremacy doctrine by manipulating white fear, attaching themselves to a flawed sense of righteousness, and through religion. and they appealed to the lost cause nostalgia over the South's defeat in the Civil War. As one of the most significant domestic terrorist organizations in American history, the Ku Klux Klan represented more than a reflection of nativism. It profoundly influenced and undergirded racial and social thought and attitude, particularly towards African Americans.